أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإن من أهل الكتاب إلا ليؤمنن به قبل موته ويوم القيامة يكون عليهم شهيدا. صدق الله العظيم. The section, last section of Surah An-Nisa, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the people of the book, it is continuing. And the discussion about Hazrat Masih alayhi salatu was salam. وَإِن مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا لَيُؤْمِنَنَّ بِهِ قَبْلَ مَوْتِهِ. And there will be none among the people of the book, except that they will have to believe in him before his death. This ayah is very important. Although people have misinterpreted it in many ways, but according to the beliefs of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Hazrat Masih alayhi salatu wasalam will come again in this world. And all the people who will be present of the book at that time, they will believe in him. Maybe some Jews also of that time will believe in him. But those who don't will, who will not believe in him even at that time, they will all be eliminated. Just as the nations who denied to accept the messengers of Allah, they were all eliminated. The people of Nuh, the people of Hud, the nation of Saleh, the people of Shu'aib, the cities to which Hazrat Lut was sent, and so on. Fir'aun and his men, all were finished, all were eliminated, because they didn't accept the messenger which was sent to them. Now Hazrat Masih alayhi salam was sent to the Jews, Rasulan ila Bani Israel. We have read it in Surah Al Imran. And the Jews rejected him. So they deserve the same punishment. Although this punishment has been deferred by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the second coming of the Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam. Because he was just lifted. And he will return again. And when he returns again, either all the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians, will believe in him, or they will be eliminated. So whosoever will remain, they will necessarily believe in him. Then you know death will come to him. This has been given clearly in hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has not yet died. He was not crucified. He didn't die. He was not killed. So there is no question of resurrection up till now. Resurrection will be after death. Death is yet to come to him. When he returns to this earth, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ tells us he will marry, he will beget children, then death will come to him, and he will be buried along with the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ in the same, you know, hujra of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So these are the things which we believe on the authority of authentic ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to these things this ayah is pointing. Wa in min ahli al-kitab illa layu'minanna bihi qabla mawtihi. That is, everyone believing in the books will necessarily believe in him before his death. Wa yawm al-qiyamati yakunu alaihim shahida. And on the day of judgment, on the day of resurrection, he will be a witness against them. Because this we have seen, كَيْفَ إِذَا جَيْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجَيْنَا بِكَ عَلَىٰ هَٰؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. The messengers were sent to the nations, and they conveyed the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to them. But then on the day of judgment, in the divine court, they will stand up as court witnesses, as prosecution witnesses. They will testify, O Allah, the message that came to me from you, I conveyed to them. Now they are responsible. So this is the shahada which all the prophets and messengers of Allah will give. This is the testimony that they will testify in the court of Allah, divine court of the last day. فَبِظُلْمِ مِنَ الَّذِينَ هَادُوا حَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ طَيِّبَاتٍ أُحِلَّتْ لَهُمْ وَبِصَدِّهِمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَثِيرًا. Two more charges against the Jews. And because of the evil doings of those people, those Jews who became Jews, حَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ طَيِّبَاتٍ. This term Jew was adopted by them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the name Bani Israel. But they adapted this word Yahud for themselves. Yahuda was one of the sons of Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salatu was salam. And then actually they attribute themselves to him. So that is the term adopted by them. That is why Allah says, Allazina Hadu, they became Jews. They became Yahud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give them this title. Quran gives them the title, Ya Bani Israel. فَبِظُلْمِ مِنَ الَّذِينَ هَادُوا. So due to the evil doings of these who became Jews, حَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ طَيِّبَاتٍ أُحِلَّتْ لَهُمْ. We declared for them as forbidden some of the very clean things also that were already declared beforehand as permissible. As a punishment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world, He punished these people and declared something which were clean in themselves, which were not prohibited, which were permissible to be used, but they were declared unlawful for them. وَبِصَدِّهِمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And this was also due to, we are stopping the people and they are holding back themselves from the path of Allah. صَدَّ يَسُدُّ, I told you, it means to hold back yourself and to stop the other. It has both the meanings. They held back. They didn't accept the faith, they didn't accept the Rasul, and secondly, they were stopping others, obstructing the way of the others from the path of the belief and faith. وَأَخْذَهِمُ الرِّبَى. Another charge. They are accepting riba, usury, eating usury. وَقَدْ نُهُوا عَنْهُ. And they were forbidden from that. وَأَخْلِهِمْ أَمْوَالَ النَّاسِ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Another charge. Due to their eating the properties of others, devouring, consuming the properties which were not belonging to them, which belonged to others, bil batil, through false methods, wrong methods, haram methods. وَعَتَدْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ مِنْهُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا. And we have prepared for those of them who have now rejected even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those of them who have now accepted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they believe in him, they have mended their ways, well, they are among the Muslims now. But those of them that have refuted this prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rejected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَعَتَرْنَا لِلْكَافِرِينَ مِنْهُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا. And now there is an exception. لَكِنِ الرَّاسُخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ مِنْهُمْ. Because from among them there were who rejected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the majority of them did so. But there were exceptions, a few of them. For example, Abdullah ibn Salam radiyallahu ta'ala, he was a big alim of Yahud, from the Jews, a big knowledgeable person, a big rabbi. لَكِنِ الرَّاسُخُونَ فِي الْإِلْمِ مِنْهُمْ. On the contrary, those among them who are well grounded in knowledge, who are deeply and firmly rooted in knowledge, رَاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ, they have the true knowledge and they are deeply rooted and well grounded in that knowledge. Wal mu'minun, and these mu'mins who are believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yu'minuna bima unzila ilayka wa ma unzila min qablik. Now both they are bracketed together because they are believing in what has been sent down to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yu'minuna bima unzila ilayka wa ma unzila min qablik. And also they believe in that which was sent before. The same words appeared again. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, aminu billahi wa rasulihi wal kitabil ladhi nazzala ala rasulihi wal kitabil ladhi nazzala min qabl. لَاكِنِ الرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ مِنْهُمْ. Now those of the Jews who had well-grounded knowledge, who had firmly deep knowledge, and these Mu'mins who are believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now they both believe in what has been sent to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also on what was said before. وَالْمُقِيمِينَ الصَّلَاةِ, and they establish prayers. وَالْمُوتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ, and they pay the poor tax, the obligatory charity. وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and they believe, have faith, deep faith and conviction in Allah and the last day. أُولَٰئِكَ سَنُوتِيهِمْ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. So these people are those whom we shall give a very great reward. Now another very important subject regarding the philosophy of Quran, and especially the philosophy of the institution of prophethood and messengerhood of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna awhayna ilayka, ilayka. Now, this is the address direct to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna awhayna ilayka. We have sent our revelations to you. Kama awhayna ila Nuhin. Just as we had sent our revelations to Nuh alayhi salatu wa sallam. وَالنَّبِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ, and so many other prophets, to them also we sent our revelations. وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ وَالْأَسْبَاطِ وَعِيسَىٰ وَأَيُّوبَ وَيُونُسَ وَهَارُونَ وَسُلَيْمَانَ وَآتَيْنَا دَاوُودَ زَبُورًا. And we sent our revelations to Ibrahim, to Ismail, to Ishaq, to Yaqub, and their progeny, and Jesus, Isa, Ayyub, and Yunus, Jonah, and Harun, and Sulaiman, and Zabura, and to David, to Dawood, we gave Zabur, we gave the Psalms. So this is a special, you know, mention of Psalm, because that is also one of the books of Allah. Torah, Zabur, Injil, Quran. So because that is a special point about Hazrat Dawood, so he has been mentioned separately. Now this is like a flower pot of the names of prophets and messengers of Allah. And you will find time and again in the Quran, at different places, these names are enumerated, you know. Just like a flower plot, all these names come together. Inna awhayna ilayka kama awhayna ila Nuhin wa nabiyyina min ba'dihi wa awhayna ila Ibrahim wa Ismail wa Ishaq wa Yaqub wa al-Asbat wa Isa wa Ayyub wa Yunus wa Harun wa Sulaiman wa atayna Dawood Zabura. Now that point which I explained already, وَرُسُلًا قَدْ قَصَصْنَاهُمْ عَلَيْكُ, and we have sent those messengers also whom we have mentioned to you before. وَرُسُلًا لَمْ نَقْصُصْهُمْ عَلَيْكُ, and there were sent other messengers also who have not been mentioned to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now please understand this point. The names of the other messengers of Allah, prophets of Allah, if they were to be given in Quran, the knowledge of history and geography would have to be given first. If a Nabi came to China, what is China? Where is China? They didn't know the history of China. If somebody had come in India, they didn't know the history of India. So actually in Quran, only the names of the messengers and prophets who were sent in the Middle East, this area. Because these people, who were the first addressees of Quran, the Arabian peoples, they knew the history. They knew the name of Dawood and Sulaiman. They knew the name of Hazrat Lut and Hazrat Saleh. Because they were all sent to this area. In their traditions, in their literature, in their poetries, these people were mentioned. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given in Quran only the history of the messengers and prophets who were sent in this area. But principally we believe that to every region prophets were sent. وَإِن مِّن قَرْيَةٍ إِلَّا خَلَا فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. There has no town in which we have not sent any warner. إِن مِّن قَرْيَةٍ إِلَّا خَلَا فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. To every nation we sent a guidance, a guider, who used to guide to the right path. وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا وَإِن مِّن قَرْيَةٍ إِلَّا خَلَا فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. So to every region prophets have come. And there has been, you know, a mention in the Kashf of Hazrat Ahmad Sarhandi Rahmatullah Alayh. He says that 30 prophets of Allah are buried in that region of East Punjab. East Punjab, where is Sarhand situated, where Ahmad Sarhandi, Mujaddid al-Fisani Rahmatullah Alayh, is also buried. He says in the nearby region, 30 prophets of Allah are buried. Now this can be a Kashf, you know, to a Waliullah. He can know it. We can't know it, these things. But you know, these people, they have those eyes which can pierce and see things beyond matter. They had the faculty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to whomsoever He likes. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was sitting in the mosque and delivering his khutbah, Juma sermon in Medina. And you know, he saw the battlefield in Syria. And he saw that Sariya radiallahu anhu, he was commanding the Muslim army at that time. He was committing a mistake. And Hazrat Umar tells him, Ya Sariyato, ilal jabal, what are you doing? You should go to their side. You should take the protection of mountain. You should keep the mountain behind you. And Hazrat Sariya listened to his voice over there. So now today, if you can convey your message from here to Pakistan through telephone or something, well, these things could be done without these means. Now we can very easily believe in these things. 100 years ago it was very difficult for people to believe. But today it's very easy for us to believe. By simple, you know, these machines and instruments, if we can do it, why can't Allah do it without the machines? These things can be done. So actually, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been sending His messengers and prophets to every region of the world. But we can't be sure. There is an opinion that Mahatma Gautam Buddha was a Nabi. I tend to agree with this. Tend to agree, but we can't be sure. And this is the opinion of Maulana Manazir Ahsan Gilani Rahmatullah Alayh, one of very big ulama of Indian subcontinent of this century, the beginning of this century. Manazir Ahsan Gilani, he is of the view that Zulkifl, who is mentioned in Quran, we know nothing about him, no details. Only twice in Quran his name appears as Zulkifl. And he says he is Kapal Vastu Wala. Kapal Vastu. He was the prince of Kapal Vastu. Kapal Vastu ka shahzada. Kapal, doesn't occur in Arabic. It is changed into Fa. So Kapal Kafl, Zulkifl, Kifl Wala. He is the person mentioned in Quran according to him, but we can't be sure. But I tend to agree with him. But you know, we must believe that definitely in other regions also prophets of Allah have been sent, messengers of Allah also came, but only the names of this region were mentioned. وَرُسُلًا قَدْ قَصَصْنَاهُمْ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَرُسُلًا لَمْ نَقْصُصْهُمْ عَلَيْكَ وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. And Allah talked to Moses as it is talked. Don't think it is proverbial. He talked to him directly, in a direct dialogue. So that was special for Dawood, Vaatena Dawooda Zabura. And in the next ayah, because it is something special. Even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't have the chance to talk to Allah directly while on this earth. He had a direct conversation only on the night of ascent. Night of Miraj, not here. But it is a special point for Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. He talked to Allah. Kallam Allahu Musa taklima. It's literally he talked. Allah talked to him directly, in direct dialogue. Now comes that ayah which I was referring, that it is most important ayah regarding the philosophy of the institution of prophethood. رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْزِرِينَ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. We have been sending these messengers as Mubashireens and Munzireens. Mubashireens, bearers of glad tidings. For whom? Who believe, who accept the faith, who do good deeds. They bring to them the glad tidings. Paradise is waiting for you. A welcome awaits you there. Jannah is waiting for you. Open arms, open gates. Glad tidings. Abshiru bil jannati allati kuntum tu'adun. Have the good tidings. And they are warners for whom? Who reject the faith. Don't believe in Allah. Don't believe in the messengers. Don't, you know, they believe in the books. They are not doing good deeds. So this is the basic function of Nabi. No Nabi had the power to bring anybody forcibly to the right path. Even Muhammad couldn't do it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even for his own uncle. Although he protected him, he loved him. And definitely Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also loved him. Then he should have been grateful to him also, because he was protecting him. And how, you know, he would have loved that he should accept Islam. That is why even on his deathbed, the Prophet said to him, "Oh my uncle, you utter these words, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, only in my ears you utter, I'll testify on the Day of Judgment." But he refused. And that is why Quran says, "Innaka la tahdi man ahbabta walakin Allah yahdi man yasha." Oh Muhammad, you cannot guide anybody whom you like. It's only Allah who guides anybody he likes. This authority rests with Allah only. You are Mubashir, you are Nazir. These two words are very important. They are repeated so many times. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا مُبَشِّرًا وَنَزِيرًا Surah Bani Israel, last section. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا مُبَشِّرًا وَنَزِيرًا In Surah Kahf, رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْزِرِينَ وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْذِرِينَ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ شَاهِدًا وَمُبَشِّرًا وَنَذِيرًا وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا So Bashara and Inzar, glad tidings and warnings. These are the two main functions, basic functions. لِأَلَّا why? لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرَّسُولِ So that there remains for the people any excuse, any plea against Allah after the messengers. What does it mean? When the messenger has come, he has conveyed the message of Allah, he has shown the right path, he has presented a personal example also. Now nobody can plead ignorance. Oh Allah, we didn't know. Nobody showed us the path. Nobody called us to the right way. Nobody told us what you like and what you dislike. How come you are accounting us for something which we were not told? We shouldn't be accountable for those things which were not told to us. Although a human being is accountable on the basis of the faculties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا We had given you the intellect. We have given you the heart. لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا All these things. All human beings are basically responsible on the Day of Judgment on the basis of the faculties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. But now when Rasul has come, when a messenger has come, he has given the correct message and he has presented an example also, practical example. Not only showed the path, he acted upon the deen himself and presented his example before people. Now there can be no excuse, no plea on the Day of Judgment. Rusulam mubashirin wa munzirin li Allah yakuna linnase ala Allah. Now again see, lam and ala. Linnase hujja, ala nase hujja. There should remain no hujja, no excuse, no plea, no argument in favor of people against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why I told you, Al-Quran hujjatul laka aw alayka. Quran is either an argument in your favor or against you. In the same way, shahada is against someone and in favor of someone. Shahida lahu, shahida alayhi. That is, witnesses testify against someone and testifying in his favor, shahida lahu. Because this word will again appear in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Rusulam mubashirin wa munzirin li Allah yakuna linnasi ala Allah hujjatun ba'da rusul. Wa kana Allahu azizan hakima. Allah is ever powerful, all authorized. He could bring you to book on any basis, but he is hakim. He is the wise. He is all wisdom. So he has designed this system of nabuwa and risala that he has been sending his message of wahi to so many people. Inna ohayna, now revert to that ayah. Inna ohayna ilayka kama ohayna ila nuhin wal nabiyina min ba'dihi. Wa ohayna ila Ibrahim wa Ismaila wa Ishaqa wa Yaqub wa Asbat wa Isa wa Ayyuba wa Yunus wa Haruna wa Sulaymana wa atayna Dawuda Zabura wa kallam Allah Musa taklima. All these people were sent. Why? It was no exercise in futility. It was not a hobby with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a basic thing about the accountability of the Day of Judgment, that after these messengers have come, now nobody can plead ignorance. Now nobody can take the refuge that, oh Allah, I didn't know. You knew it. Everything was made clear to you. Even a practical example was produced before you in the person of the messenger. Rasulan مبشرين ومنذرين لئلا يكون للناس على الله حجة بعد الرسل وكان الله عزيزا حكيما لكن الله يشهد بما أنزل إليك أنزله بعلمه والملائكة يشهدون. But Allah bears witness Himself with what He has sent down to you, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, that He has sent down that with His knowledge. It is out of His knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent this book to you. This is a part of His knowledge, a part of His wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, has blessed you with. And not only Allah is a witness to it, all the angels are witness to it. لَكِنِ اللَّهُ يَشْهَدُ بِمَا أَنزَلَ إِلَيْكَ أَنزَلَهُ بِعِلْمِهِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يَشْهَدُونَ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And you know this testimony of the angels is mentioned, although Allah Himself is sufficient as a witness. He doesn't need any additional witness. But because it is a fact, this fact has been mentioned, that all the angels are also witnesses to it. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَصَدُّوا عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Verily, and certainly and surely, those who adopt kufr, ungratefulness, unthankfulness. Now what should be the thankfulness? When Allah has sent the book, Allah has sent the messenger, you believe in him. You should benefit from the teachings. You should benefit from the divine guidance. This is shukr. And if you are not using these things, it is kufr. It is thanklessness, ungratefulness. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And then they rejected the faith. They didn't believe in it. وَصَدُّوا عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Saddha again both ways. They themselves held back in not believing in it. And they also stopped others. Put hurdles in the ways of the others also, that they should also not accept it. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَصَدُّوا عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Now this was the character of the Yahud. They, not only they didn't believe in Muhammad themselves, they also were stopping. And they were exerting to their utmost that nobody should believe in him. قَدَّلُّوا دَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. They have gone astray. They have gone far astray. They have deviated from the right path to a very great distance. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَظَلَمُوا لَمْ يَكُنِ اللَّهُ لِيَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ. Again repeating, those who have unbelieved, who have rejected this faith, and who are the evildoers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to pardon them, not going to forgive them, لِيَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ وَلَا لِيَهْدِيَهُمْ طَرِيقًا, and is not going to show them any path, lead them to any path, إِلَّا طَرِيقَ جَهَنَّمْ, except the path of the hell. Now this path is only open for them. إلا طريق جهنم خالدين فيها and they will dwell in it, abide by it, in it forever, forever. وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرًا And on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is easy. Don't think it is very difficult for Allah to do it. Ya Yuhannas, now there is a direct address also. Up till now to the Jews, it was all a long charge sheet, not addressing them directly. But here for once in this surah also, now they are directly addressed. And in a very appealing way. Ya Yuhannas, O mankind, although these words are common, but you know who are being addressed here are the people of the book. Ya Yuhannas, O people. قَدْ جَاكُمْ الرَّسُولُ بِالْحَقِّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ Our messenger has come to you with the total truth from your Lord. فَآمِنُوا خَيْرًا لَكُمْ Believe in him. Have faith in him. Accept him. It is better for you. وَإِنْ تَكْفُرُوا And if you reject him, if you deny him, if you don't believe in him, if you disbelieve him, فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ So Allah doesn't care for you. Because to him belongs all the things, whatever is in the heavens or is in the earth. So he doesn't care for you. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا And verily Allah is ever knowing, all wise. Ya al-kitab. Now again, Ya al-kitab includes both the Jews and the Christians. But here, really the Christians are addressed. Ya al-kitab, la taghlu fi deenikum. Don't exaggerate in your religion. It is the charge against the Christians. They raise the level of a messenger of Allah to Godhead. Included him in Godhead. Three in one, one in three. Some of them say he is God incarnate. Some of them, it is one aspect of Godhead. Three aspects of Godhead. But they have raised the level. This is ghulu, exaggeration. They have not denied. They have not rejected Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. That is why you know how much Quran emphasizes that Muhammad is messenger of Allah and his bondsman and he's a bashar. قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَٰهُكُمْ إِلَٰهٌ وَاحِدٌ فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا It's very important. Because people, when they exaggerate, and they exaggerate out of love they raise the level. And in the same way, we Muslims, among are those people who have raised Muhammad to the level of Allah, And no less a person than a very great, very big alim. Ahmad Raza Khan Barelvi. And it is his couplet. وَهِي جو مُسْتَوِيِ عَرْشْ تھا خُدَا ہو کر اُتر پڑا وہ مدینے میں مُصطفیٰ ہو کر The same person who was on the arsh as Khuda, as God, descended down in Medina in the form of Mustafa. What is the difference between the Christian belief and the belief of these Muslims? So they are very close to each other. And it is ghuluv. So this word is very important. Ya ahl al-kitab la taghlu fi deenikum. Wa la taqulu ala Allah illa al-haq. Don't attribute to Allah except what is truth. إِنَّمَا الْمَسِيحُ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ Verily, Al-Masih, Jesus, son of Mary, is a messenger of Allah. وَكَلِمَتُهُ And is a word from him, أَلْقَاهَا إِلَى مَرْيَمَ Which he sent down to Mary. وَرُوحٌ مِّنْهُ And is a spirit from him. But each one of us has a spirit from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَسَلُونَكَ عَلِ الْرُوحِ قُلِ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي But there is a difference of grades. حِفْزِ بَرَاتِ بْنَا قُلِ زِنْدِيقِ Ruh of Muhammad and ruh of me or you. کہ نسبت خاک رہا بعالم پاک. So actually this is also ruh of minhu, ruh of حضرت مسیح علیہ السلام is a special spirit, no doubt. But it is the spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلِ رُوحُ مِنْ عَمْرِ رَبِّي. So that is the position. اِنَّمَا الْمَسِيحُ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ number one وَقَلِمَتُهُ number two أَلْقَاهَا إِلَى مَرْيَمْ وَرُوحُ مِنْهُ فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ. So have faith and have belief in Allah and His messengers. All are messengers. I don't remember, you know, fully the couplets in مُسَدَّ سِحَالِ مگر مومنوں پر کشادہ ہیں راہیں وہ نبیوں کا رتبہ خدا سے بڑھائیں اماموں کا رتبہ نبی سے ملائیں. I don't remember the verse, you know, but I am giving the essence. If the Christians do it, they are kuffar. If we do it, we are mominin. The crime is the same. The sin is the same. They also didn't reject Jesus. They raised him to the level of Godhead. And we also, out of love, extreme love for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have raised him to that level. فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ. So have faith in Allah and His messengers. فَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثَا. Don't say three. Don't believe in Trinity. انتهوا. Stop here. خَيْرًا لَكُمْ. This is good for you. إِنَّمَا اللَّهُ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. Allah is the one. He is the only God. سُبْحَانَهُ وَيَكُونَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. He is much exalted, much above and beyond this position that he might beget a son. This doesn't become of him. He doesn't require a son. Why? Son is required by a person. Why? Because he knows he has to die. So his name, you know, will be remembered by the son, and then the son of the son. It's as if I am continuing. Some existence of my own is continuing through my progeny. That is why we very much wish that we should have sons. It's a continuation of our own existence. But Allah himself is never to die. He is there. He is continuous. وَاللَّهُ بَاقِي مِن كُلِّ فَانٍ. So he doesn't need any son. سُبْحَانَهُ أَن يَكُونَ لَهُ وَلَدْ. He is much above it, much exalted, much beyond this level, that he might beget a son. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. To him belongs everything, all the things which are in the heavens and in the earth. وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا. And Allah is sufficient as a protector and a guardian. لَنْ يَسْتَنْكِفَ الْمَسِيحُ أَن يَكُونَ عَبْدًا لِلَّهِ. Masih is not going to feel it a humiliation that he is an abd of Allah. Neither Muhammad feels it to be a humiliation. We testify along with prophethood and messengerhood. نَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَنَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Rather the more emphasis is on abduhu. At so many places in Quran you will find, you know, abduhu mentioned, not rasuluhu. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا. تبارك الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا. فتس عبد عبد دیگر عبده چیزے دیگر. ما سراپا انتظارو منتظر. But I don't have time to translate this couplet. لَنْ يَسْتَنْكِفَ الْمَسِيحُ أَنْ يَكُونَ عَبْدًا لِلَّهِ وَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ الْمُقَرَّبُونَ. Even, you know, the angels were very close and very near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't feel ashamed and don't feel humiliated that they are the abds, they are the bondsmen, they are the slaves of Allah. وَمَنْ يَسْتَنْكِفْ عَنْ عِبَادَتِهِ. Whosoever feels ashamed in the bondsmanship of Allah, whosoever feels that it is humiliating for him that he be regarded as a bondsman to Allah, as a servant to Allah. فَسَيَحْشُرُهُمْ إِلَيْهِ جَمِيعًا. So Allah will gather them together before him. They will have to come to him. If they feel it to be humiliated, well, they will have the humiliation on the day of judgment. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. So as for those who had believed and done good, فَيُوَفِّيهِمْ أُجُورَهُمْ, He will pay them their rewards in full. وَيَزِيدُهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ, adding to them yet more out of his bounty. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ اسْتَنْكَفُوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا, and as for those who felt ashamed to be servants of Allah and who became arrogant, وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا, then فَيُعَذِّبُهُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا, Allah will chastise them, punish them with a very painful chastisement, painful punishment. وَلَا يَجِدُونَ لَهُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلِيًّا وَلَا نَصِيرًا, and they won't be able to find for them against Allah. This doon, you know, this can be translated in many ways, except Allah. But here, this proper word is against Allah. They will not be able to find any protector, any helper against Allah. Ya Yuhannas, now this is, so to say, the end of the surah. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بُرْحَانٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ نُورًا مُّبِينًا. O mankind, a clear sign and proof has come to you. That clear sign and proof is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is himself a burhan. Kirdar mein, guftar mein, Allah ki burhan. Allama Iqbal uses these words for Banda-e-Mumin. Kirdar mein, guftar mein, Allah ki burhan. If a mu'min is a burhan, well, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the completest burhan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya ayyuhannas, qad jaakum burhanum min rabbikum wa anzalna ilaykum nuran mubina, and we have sent down to you a very shining light. That shining light is this. Burhan is Muhammad. رسول من الله يتلو صحفا مطهرة فيها كتب قيمة لم يكن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب والمشركين منفكين حتى تأتيهم البينة. And what is that بينة? رسول من الله يتلو صحفا مطهرة فيها كتب قيمة. Here the رسول is برهان and the book that is the نور. وأنزلنا إليكم نورا مبينا. We have sent down. نزول is for Quran. A light which is very shining, very manifest light. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاعْتَصَمُوا بِهِ. Now as for those who believe in him, who have faith in him, who have accepted him as their leader, as their guide, as their mentor, وَاعْتَصَمُوا بِهِ, and have clung to him, who have believed in Allah and has clung to Allah, hold fast to Allah. Hold fast to Allah, believing in him, holding fasting to Allah, holding fast to his deen, holding fast to Allah, holding fast to his rope, to his cable. And that rope and cable is Quran. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. And the Prophet said, هُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَتِينَ. According to a hadith narrated by Hazrat Ali رضي الله تعالى عنه. And in another hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, الْقُرْآنُ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَمْدُودُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ. This Quran is a rope of Allah which is stretching between the earth and the skies and heavens. And in another hadith, the wordings are, tarafuhu bi'adikum wa tarafuhu bi'adillah. It is such a rope that one end of that rope is in your hands and the other end of the rope is in the hands of Allah. Tarafuhu bi'adikum wa tarafuhu bi'adillah. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاعْتَصَمُوا بِهِ فَسَيُدْخِلُهُمْ فِي رَحْمَةٍ مِّنْهُ. He will make them enter. He will admit them to his mercy. وَفَضْلٍ, and his bounty. This rahmah is for forgiveness. If they had some shortcomings, some bad deeds also, the rahmah will wipe it out. And the fazl is the bounties of Jannah. سَيُدْخِلُهُمْ فِي رَحْمَةٍ مِّنْهُ وَفَضْلٍ وَيَهْدِيهِمْ إِلَيْهِ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. And he will guide them, lead them, إِلَيْهِ يَهْدِيهِمْ إِلَيْهِ, towards Allah. Note it. This is called suluk. What is suluk? What is tariqat? تَقَرُّبْ إِلَى اللَّهِ. You want to be nearer and nearer and nearer and closer and closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But to become closer and closer to Allah, you need a path. That is called suluk. That is called tariqat. That is called shariat. There is no difference between shariat. Share means path. Tariq means path. This is only the two aspects of that path. The legal side, the external side is sharia. The inner side, the hidden side is tariqah. Sharia tells you how to pray. And tariqat will tell you what should you feel when you are praying. You are standing, you have folded your hands, you have gone bowed down in ruku, you are prostrating in sujood. This is sharia. But you know, your whole personality is bowing before Allah. You are really submitting. Do you really feel you are in the presence of Allah? Do you really have a direct conversation with Allah? That is the tariqah. So sharia and tariqah together. The only difference is the external, visible side, legal side, fiqhi side is sharia. The internal, the real essence, the real spirit of these things, that is dealt by tariqah. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاعْتَصَمُوا بِهِ فَسَيُدْخِلُهُمْ فِي رَحْمَةٍ مِّنْهُ فَضْلٍ وَيَهْدِيهِمْ إِلَيْهِ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. He will guide them to a straight path leading towards Him. Now the surah has ended. Only one appendix. This ayah, you know, it is the appendix. Ayah number 176. A question about the law of inheritance. Just as we had, you know, some instructions in the first section of this surah about women, about orphans, orphan girls. But there were certain questions about doing justice between the wives if you have more than one wife. About those also there were questions. Those questions were later on explained. يَسْتَفْتُونَكَ فِي النِّسَاءِ قُلِ اللَّهُ يُفْتِيكُمْ فِيهِنَّ. Now again there was the law of inheritance about kalala. Some instructions came. Now there was a question. Yastaftunaka, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they want a proclamation and a pronouncement from you. They are wanting a fatwa from you. Qulillahu yuftikum fil kalala. Say to them, well, Allah is pronouncing and Allah is giving you the verdict about kalala. Allah wants to remove your doubts or misunderstandings about kalala. In imra'un halaka, laysa lahu waladun wa lahu ukhtun. If somebody dies, some person, he doesn't have any parent, nor any son or daughter. He is called a kalala. Now if he has a wife, wife will get 1/4. To whom shall 3/4 go? Wife can get only 1/4. To whom will 3/4 go? To the brothers and sisters. They are called Zawil Arham. Zawil Farais. Zawil Farais are only three. Parents, father, mother, grouped together. And the progeny, sons and daughters. And wife and husband. They are the Zawil Farais. Their portions in the inheritance are fixed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His book, in the second section of Surah An-Nisa. In very profound ayat. Only two ayat, and it gives the full law of inheritance. Now, if something remains, or in this case, when there are no parents, they had already died, there are no children surviving, maybe they died before the death of this person, or he was issueless. Now, if there is a wife, she will get 1/4. 3/4 will go where? And if the wife also doesn't exist, then who will inherit? The brothers and the sisters. Now, what will happen? These brothers and sisters will behave just as sons and daughters behaved in the law of inheritance. What is it? If there was one son, he would inherit the whole. If one daughter, she would inherit half. If two or more than two daughters, they will be equally divided between them in the 2/3. such law was given in the beginning. And that is the same case for the real brothers and sisters. There in the second section, the commandment was given for akhlafi, step brothers and sisters. And I told you that in Arabic custom, when father is common, irrespective of whether the mother is also common or mothers are different, they are called real brothers. They are equal in status, no difference. Although there are two terms, aini. Aini are those where father and mother are both common. Allati. Allati are those brothers and sisters who have a common father but different mothers. The third is akhlafi. Mother is common, fathers are different. Akhlafi. So if they are akhlafi brethren or sisters or brothers, the law is given in the very beginning in the second section of Surah An-Nisa. But people were bewildered. What about the real ones? So this real one is given here. وَلَهُ وَلَدٌ وَلَهُ أُخْتٌ فَلَهَا نِصْفُ مَا تَرَكُ. Just as a single daughter could have inherited only half, so if a single sister is there, real, Annie or Allati, she will inherit only half. وَهُوَ يَرِسُهَا إِلَّمْ يَكُلْ لَهَا وَلَدٌ. And if a woman dies without any aulad, without any progeny and parents, and he has a, she has a brother, brother will inherit full whole of it. Just as the son, you know, if he was alone, the only son, he would have inherited the whole of it. So if there is only one brother, he will have the total inheritance. If a sister, then half. فَإِنْ كَانَتَ اثْنَتَيْنِ فَلَهُمَا ثُلُثَانِ. If there are only sisters and they are two or more than two, then you know they will have two-thirds. Mimma tarak, or whatever he has left. وَإِنْ كَانُوا إِخْوَةً وَرِجَالًا وَنِسَانًا. And if there are brothers and sisters, both. فَلِلْزَّكَرِ مِسْلُ حَزْدِ الْأُنْسَيَيْنِ. The same wordings with which that law started. يُوسِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِهِ لِلْزَّكَرِ مِسْلُ حَزْدِ الْأُنْسَيَيْنِ. So if there are brothers and sisters, now the whole thing will be divided according to that rule, that for each male will be the portion equal to two females. يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ أَن تَضِلُّوا. Allah is making it, explaining it clearly to you, lest you should go astray. Although you could deduce it from there also. Allah had not gone into detail, because you could use your own intellect to understand it. But because you couldn't understand it, and it may be that you might commit a mistake, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clear that that order or commandment or instruction was for akhlafi brothers and sisters. For anis, for allatis, where a father is common, the same law will apply as is the law about the sons and daughters. Antadillu, yubayyinu Allahu lakum antadillu, wallahu bi kulli shayin alim. And verily Allah knows everything. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim, wa nafa'ani wa iyaakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-hakim.
Allahu akbar,
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us. or call our toll-free number, 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.